Marc Storace of Krokus, it is an honor to talk to you.
You could even say Storace, like the Italians say, you know, it's the real way to say it.
I would love to say Marc Storace then, because you know what? Now you've corrected me after 30-something years.
Well, you know, it was always different. It depended which country we played in. You know, in France, they said Storace. In the USA, they said Storace.
And,
you know, like Liberace, Versace, Storace. But it's an Italian name, so it's really Storace, you know, Storace. But, you know, I don't mind as long as they mean me.
Well, you know what? I'll tell you what. My last name is De Lamont, which is French because I'm from New Orleans.
And beautiful name, yeah.
Oh, well, thank you.
I wanted to ask about that.
Yeah, so I was born and raised in New Orleans, but I'll tell you what, man, anybody can butcher this last name. I've heard every version of this name, you know, that's not the right way. Ooh, now see, that's how my dad would prefer people to say it, but we always just said, yeah, you know, De Lamont's fine. You know, as long as you get that right.
That's cool. Well, I'm right next to the French border here.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I'm in Basel country, you know, next to Basel city on the Rhine.
Oh, that's beautiful out there.
To my left, to the west is France, and up to my north is Germany, and to to the southeast and east is the rest of Switzerland. You know, I'm in the northwest corner.
That is beautiful area up there too.
Yeah, really nice. Yeah.
Like, what is one question that you get asked so much that it just drives you crazy every time someone asks you?
Yeah, I guess it's about the similarity of Krokus to AC/DC and to my voice to Bon Scott's. You know, I mean, okay, yeah. I guess we know that now, by now. And all I have to say is that Krokus has done a lot of songs that in a style that AC/DC would never touch, you know, like take Screaming in the Night, you know, our
right.
biggest ballad from our best-selling album, Headhunter. You know, it's a lovely ballad, and the only ballad AC/DC ever wrote was a blues, you know, called Ride On. And for to answer the other question, you know, because might as well get it over with. It's, you know, I guess, you know, Bon and I grew in the same era, you know, so we had the same influences, more or less, you know. And I guess both on different parts of the world, you know, in different hemispheres, but we were still whatever, mm-hmm. you know, 60s children and hard rock fans, and we had our phase of progressive music, and I don't know what happened, you know. But I definitely don't try to clone Bond, you know.
You know, that's fun. That's so cool that you said that, because one of the things I always thought about Krokus was that while there was definitely some similarity, like you said, like songs like, you know, Screaming in the Night, or even, you know, even like Headhunter, you know, was like nothing like AC/DC would do.
No.
But then Long Stick Goes Boom kind of covers that territory. But I never really... I never really compared you guys to AC/DC, other than the fact that it was a similar like guitar sound. Like, I always thought musically and lyrically it was very different from AC/DC.
Yeah, true. You know, the guitar sound, you know, what Malcolm, the riffs that he came up with, I mean, this was a different kind of mathematics behind the riffs, you know, and it was something incredible. And I guess it turned people on, it turned guitar players on. And I have nothing against anybody who is influenced by someone else. We're all influenced by someone else, you know, whether it's Queen or Led Zeppelin and, you know, Black Sabbath or whoever. We all have a background, you know. We didn't grow up with cotton wool in our ears.
Right. But at the same time, you also didn't grow up being influenced by, you know, a lot of the later era bands that came around, because, you know, a band like Krokus was already established in the, you know, late 70s, you know what I mean? And so you really, a lot of those bands weren't even so much influences as much as they were peers, because you were kind of doing stuff the same time that they were.
Well, yeah, there's not much of a gap there. Mm-hmm. And I guess, you know, I mean, AC/DC, let's face it, is good energy, you know, good rock and roll, good hard rock energy. Mm-hmm. And but there's a few other bands who have good hard rock energy, good little bit of metal in there, and you can hear something from other bands within the Krokus repertoire. Mm-hmm. As well, you know, and vice versa. You know, I mean, there was an era when we were more, you know, maybe not particularly myself, but Judas Priest became an influence for a while, you know. Mm-hmm. After the AC/DC phase, if you like. And then it went on, you know, and later on came Def Leppard. Mm-hmm. With a very commercial, poppy sound, you know. And then we went back to our original roots, you know, and by that time that grunge was here and mm-hmm. nobody doing hard rock had a hard time then, and it was time for grunge rock, you know. Mm-hmm. But it was still rock and still good stuff, you know. That's how the story goes.
Well, you know, and so the first time I ever heard Krokus was back in 84, and you know, being a young American metalhead that had just discovered heavy metal, you know, it was like I just wanted to absorb everything. And you know, from the easiest way for me to do this a lot of times was these Masters of Metal albums that a label called K-Tel put out, and there was one that I purchased in 84 that had the song Screaming in the Night on it, and it made me a fan. Like, to this day, like, I've been a Krokus fan since. Like, have you heard that a lot from others that discovered you guys, say, from those kind of compilation records?
Yeah, I think for people who wanted to get to know what a band was about that they had not bought any albums of, the best way was to buy a compilation album and catch up with the best known material that the band let out, you know.
Right.
And that way you have a kind of cross section of what a band does. But if it's only one track, you know, yes, I do. And I do know people who got to know Krokus in this manner, you know. Mm-hmm. I used to do that too. Well, in the early days, I'd buy a compilation album and get to know bands that way. And then if I liked a song, I'd buy the whole album, buy more stuff and get more interested.
Well, and that's funny because that was exactly what happened with me, was that, you know, the minute I heard Screaming in the Night, I went out and bought Headhunter like within a day. And that was where my, you know, my obsession with Krokus started. And I mean, Headhunter, and then working my way backwards also, you know, I mean, there was just some amazing albums. And you and I happened to be talking back and forth one day, and you happened to say that you felt like it was the album One Vice at a Time where Krokus really hit its stride, you know? What was it about that particular album in time where everything just seemed to kind of ignite?
Well, you know, when the energies and influences all come together and you write an album which makes sense to you, every song that's on it makes sense to you in some way or other and fits musically like you know, it all fits together basically, and I guess that came from experience and especially road experience, live experience, you know, even what we did during rehearsals, you know, we'd rehearse and during sound checks as well, we'd jam other people's songs, one or two or bits and pieces of other people's songs. And that way you start to form yourself and you keep on developing, you keep on progressing and creating until your handwork, you know, and your ideas start to kind of gel into a more focused thing, you know. Mm-hmm. And One Vice at a Time is, it's like saying one album at a time, you know. and I joined the band for Metal Rendezvous, mm-hmm. and that shot straight up into the charts and gave us the first big international kick, you know, and thanks to that, we got a deal with Arista New York, you know, mm-hmm. before that we were signed to Ariola Europe and,
right.
you know, then Hardware album we recorded in England, you know, in London. And, so it's the same thing with One Vice at a Time. We had AC/DC next door with Mutt Lung was next door mixing for those about to rock. And Malcolm was sitting in the green room smoking and sometimes would say hi and bye. You know, and we had Tony Platt, who also was Mutt Lung's engineer, producing our album. And so there was this thing of feeling like, you know, wow, we're really where we wanted to be, you know, we're in this in the family, you know, you start to feel like you're in this big world family of music and rock, you know. And
right.
Bruce Dickinson came in and sang back and vocals I'm on the Run, I think, yeah, or a couple of songs, I think, and playing the Outlaw maybe as well. And so, you know, I mean, we knew Bruce already because we'd already played with Iron Maiden a couple of times in London, and
right.
So there was this whole nice scene happening, you know, and I guess the whole vibe of the thing, you know. Made Krokus feel like, you know, we're here, we're relaxed and doing our thing and putting our heart and soul into it, you know, after being on the road for so long, since Metal Rendezvous, Hardware, and now One Vice at a Time on the way, you know. So that helps, you know, when stuff like that happens.
Yes, and one of the things that you said earlier that I thought was such a good observation was that something about those bands, like when they started, almost kind of had a proggy. It seemed like the earlier, you know, material from bands like Priest and, you had Priest, you had Scorpions, you had even the debut Saxon album. They all kind of had this kind of like a proggy sound, but yet none of them sounded like they were together. And then with Metal Rendezvous, it was more of like a kind of an in-your-face rock, but I could hear that as all of these bands started to kind of meld into another or grow into another sound, you all ended up together, you know? And so is that kind of what you were getting at as far as saying, like, you kind of felt like Krokus had kind of like come into this thing where it's like you guys all met in the middle, kind of?
Yeah, you know, and another thing you have to keep in mind, Krokus did not come from an English speaking zone,
correct,
if you like,
right.
You know, not Australian, not British, and not American. You know, more like, you know, the Scorpions. That, I mean, at that time, the Scorpions were the main German band, and Krokus was, you know, or became, Krokus became the main Swiss hard rock band. And then there was Golden Earring from Holland, mm-hmm. you know, which was making, you know, with Radar Love. Yeah, they
right.
had this big hit that, you know, which is not metal or hard rock, but still, you know, lovely song. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's so there was no kind of how can I say, it was an international rock and roll handshake, if you like, you know, which we were feeling this big, you know, pat on the back from, it was like we're all competing against each other, but yet we're all mates, you know. We're all in the same genre, you know.
It's so funny because it's so true, because, you know, if you're not competitive to begin with, then you kind of don't have that push to become
yeah.
the best band that you can be. But at the same time, you don't want to like turn your nose up at other bands and go, oh no, I have no time for you. It's like you still want to help each other out, but you want to see who can blow who off the stage. You know?
Well, yeah, that's how it was. This was the life story of Krokus, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Ever since I've known, you know, opening for other bands, whether it was with bands before Krokus or with Krokus, it was always like, you know, like to meet the guys and party after the gig and meet and talk, drink coffee or whatever before doing the sound check time, you know. But then when you psych up and put your stage clothes on and hit the stage, you know, you're all fighting you're struggling for your existence and for your success and to make your mark, you know, and to leave an impression and most of all to please the fans, because without that, you know, you're not going to come back and do another gig, you know. So it was always trying to find a way, what can we give them that they like us more, you know, that mm-hmm. they love our music more, that they buy more albums, that we have a bigger following, you know. That's how it goes.
I wish I could remember which artist said this, but it was like a musician that said, that especially as an opening act, you had to go out on stage every night like you were the headliner. Like you had to give them as much energy and as much great music as you could give, with hopes that even though you knew there was someone going to headline after you, that you wanted people to like go, oh man, Krokus was awesome. I got to get the shirt. Got to buy the album.
Exactly. Exactly. You know, headliners all normally have had a hit or two which made them into a headliner.
Right.
And maybe they're already at platinum level and they can afford the whole production and stuff, and you go on as special guest and you have to pay the headliner something for using their stage and so on. And maybe you're close to, you know, maybe you've had a hit, but maybe you're not up there yet, you know, and you have less time to prove yourself. Your little magic window is shorter, you know. So, and that's there's good and bad in that, because when you don't have to play for 2 hours, then you have more energy to give in a shorter space of time, you know.
Right.
And so, you know, a lot of fans then go home saying, wow, they really kicked ass. But they forget that the headliner has to stretch their show. They have most of them have a larger repertoire of hits, and they can take it easy. They can relax in between and then, you know, save the energy and build the show up like we learned to do later on, you know. And when you're the opening act, like our first couple of years, you know, we only had a 30-minute slot, you know, 30 minutes. You travel all that way in the bus.
And you wait so long,
you practice so hard, and then you go up, and 30 minutes is like a flash in the pan. You know, it's like, what? It's over. And so in those 30 minutes, it's like, You really have to burn and explode and give them all the thunder you can.
I just always thought it was interesting because I have a band here in Atlanta, and you know, we've played our own shows as headliners locally, you know, where we play for like, you know, hour and 15 minutes or whatever. But we have opened for bands where we were like, they were like, you have 20 minutes. And you go on like 10 minutes after the doors open. And I just remember going to my band, like, we have 20 minutes. We need to pick the four best songs that we have and, like, no bullshit, and just get out there and play as hard as we can, sweat as much as we can, talk to the crowd, you know, and it always seems to work for us. But I totally I can't even imagine that on a grander level. On a bigger scale, where, like you said, you're traveling in a bus all day. Like, hell, sometimes your sound check was longer than your actual set.
Yeah, if you get a sound check.
Well, I am also no stranger to that. Let me tell you, there's nothing more horrifying than walking out on a stage, and then the minute you start playing, you go, I can't hear shit. There's nothing coming out of these speakers.
Yeah, you know, even then, even if you're in the middle as special guest, you know, you don't have all the same volume on the PA out there blasting at the crowd as much as the headliner
right.
has, you know, which is in a way logical. And, you know, they pay for it all. And then there's all the lights, you know, you don't get as many lights and you don't have that much space on stage. So these are things you have to work at achieving, you know, so bit by bit and a little bit of negotiation, you know, hopefully with a diplomatic manager, you know, some managers can be a bit less diplomatic and in the way be a negative force, you know. So it's many elements that, you know, have to come together. But all in all, when I look back, you know, we were lucky. And I mean, I look back and think, God, we had a blessing, you know.
Right.
A band coming from Switzerland. Our whole network is here is based on foreign bands, you know, American and British bands passing through Switzerland, stopping here, doing gigs, and they get well paid, you know. But and that's it. So the local scene wasn't that big, you know.
Right.
So to having got out there on the new wave of British heavy metal, you know, as a Swiss band, was a big stroke of luck. And the other elements are, we had the right product at the right time, you know, and you know, I think the song Heat Strokes is what broke us in the USA.
Great song, by the way.
A great guy, Mr. Mike Bone in New York, sitting in New York with Arista Records. You know, he was the A&R, and he said, "I heard Heat Strokes, and I thought we've got to sign this band." You know, I mean, of course, including the rest of the album. And he went to Clive Davis, you know, and he got his blessing, and we went on to playing the USA almost for the next decade, you know, which was a great experience and probably the best in our lives, you know.
You know, when Krokus really broke into the States, kind of like you said, like, I had just heard you guys for the first time in 84, and I hadn't even had the chance to see you guys live, still haven't, which is one of the saddest things of my life as a music fan. But when you were touring in the 80s, especially here in the States, what bands did you feel like treated you guys the best as far as helping you guys push your music forward?
Well, when we first started out, we were playing sleazy clubs, you know, lots of drunk people, and it smelled like marijuana the moment you walked in, you know. and then we went on with Sammy Hagar, and he was on his tour, The Red Rocker. And we thought, wow, this guy is like filling up big halls, and he comes into our dressing rooms to ask if everything's okay. Do you need anything, boys? You know, so one by one, you know, from that we toured with Van Halen and Judas Priest. Judas mm-hmm. Priest was also one of the bands that always treated Krokus like we were some envoys from a royal whatever. You know, they had this red carpet on stage, and they asked us, "Do you want to have it there? Shall we take it away?" You know, little details like this, you know, mm-hmm. where some bands didn't even bother. You know, you felt they were like trying to sabotage you. but not with them. And we did about three big tours with them, with Judas Priest, mm-hmm. you know. And then there was Ted Nugent. He treated us real well as well. And when we toured Europe with him, we even shared the same bus, you know.
Oh, I can't even imagine
it was
that.
Great to hear all these hunting stories from the Nuge himself, you know. It was great.
That is amazing. And you know what? I have to honestly tell you that your hair back in the 80s was absolutely amazing. Like, even when I was a kid, I was like, his hair defies gravity. It is absolutely amazing. Like, no one looked like you. That was just great, man. Like, I just loved that. I'm sure you've heard that before.
I used to stick my finger in a plug, you know, and the electricity did my hair. It was like fast way to do it.
I remember I had a friend, like a good friend of mine, because I didn't have a whole lot of friends when I was younger, but this good friend of mine who was a Krokus fan also, that we used to listen to records every weekend. I just remember him saying, like, I wonder what kind of stuff he hides in his hair. You know, like, does he hide like joints and stuff in there and stuff? Those are always just great.
Yeah, it was always good going through the Canadian border, you know, and spend half a day at the Canadian border. No, joking aside. You know, I was influenced, I guess, a lot during the Woodstock era. It started, Marsha Hunt. Do you remember Marsha Hunt?
And yes.
Jimi Hendrix.
Yes. You know, I'm a big hippie.
Those kind of hairdos.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I'm from I'm an island boy. I'm from the Mediterranean, and there must be some genes, you know, genes from Italy and genes from my mom was half English, so a bit, it depends. So I have kind of very tough hair. It doesn't hang. It never hangs, you know, until it got real long, and then the curls started to hang, and I used to put some you have to put some oil in it and stuff, and you know, it's a lot of work, you know, not Brill cream, you know, right, or Vaseline, right, or whatever, but you know, these it was a big problem trying to keep it under control.
Well, you know what I just love, but, though, is that like Krokus had this look that, again, kind of like what you said, you didn't have an American look to you, but it just stuck out to me. You know what I mean? Like, as in, like, these guys don't look like everybody, which I loved as a music fan. You know what I mean? Because, like, you can only have so many Motley Crues or, like, so many Poisons, you know? Yeah. Like, to me, it's like, wow, Krokus is much
our tour manager, Little Dave, you know, he was 7 feet tall. he was the henchman who brought out the axe for Fernando to smash the guitar with.
Oh,
and he was a,
I did not know that.
A really nice, big, kind-hearted black guy, you know, whom I still love till today. We're still in contact, and he threw Motley Crue out of our dressing room in L.A. But I mean, they were not famous yet, you know. They were, and he thought they were just some local band on drugs trying to get backstage into our dressing room. And, you know, it's like, you know, leave my boys alone kind of thing, you know. And little did we know, we didn't have a crystal ball. We couldn't see what these guys would turn into, you know, in the future. And Poison used to hang out in Sportsman's Lodge in the valley in our hotel towards the end. And we didn't know either. Shit like this happens, you know. You have to take it in your stride and not be too serious about it. Or, if you're on the receiving end, not be offended about it, you know. He was just doing his job, trying to keep his boys clean, you know.
The whole turning point with you guys in the States and everything was, I mean, that you guys were getting a lot of press also. I mean, I couldn't open up like Hit Parade or Circus or Cream or, you know, any of those hard rock magazines. It was always something about, you know, had to do with Krokus. And I know you get asked a lot about this, but I just wanted to acknowledge it, was that I remember reading the whole thing with Dee Snider fiasco, you know? And and like all these years, like people still just talk about, and I'm like, does anybody even remember what happened? who cares? Krokus is great. Yeah, Twisted Sister was great. Like, they were both great. Who cares if they were arguing about, you know, stage clothes or whatever?
When we saw Twisted Sister the first time, it was an open air in Phoenix, Arizona. Mm-hmm. And we all, like, dashed out of the dressing room to listen, you know. We ain't gonna take it, you know, and all that, because Dee was very kind of politically minded, and he was saying a lot of the right things, you know, at that time. And we thought, wow, if we were used to hanging out, you know, and touring with the Nuge, you know, Ted Nugent, who is a rapper, you know, he talks a lot in between songs and stuff. And here was another guy coming out with new stuff, you know, and we all thought, great, you know, it's great shit, you know, great stuff. Mm-hmm. And then suddenly this thing happened with the stage clothes and his wife, and it's not worth repeating, you know. For me, it's like water under the bridge. But if some people have to kind of digest, or maybe they are influenced by other people around them, you know.
Right. to kind of go back to the albums and the songs, there's a question I always wanted to ask you ever since I was a kid, and that is, who was Smelly Nelly? Who was that actually a person? Like, who was that?
No, it's it was nobody I knew. Well, Chris came up with these lyrics, and I said, are you sure you want to sing this kind of lyric? You know? And he said, well, go ahead. You know, if anybody asks, then say it was my uncle. My uncle who lives in London wrote these lyrics for us, and that's it, you know. So it's if anybody blames you for being disgusting, you know, singing disgusting lyrics, I mean, oh God,
it's so funny because that was like such a cult hit among Krokus fans, you know. Like, it wasn't like it was like a single or a song that was necessarily played a lot, but I just remember just thinking, yeah, like, this song is fucking great, man. This is hilarious. I love this song.
I mean, there's only one thing to do about it, and that's to laugh, you know. It's all you can do. But, I mean, and you know, my consolation is when I, in the 70s, I used to listen to a lot of Frank Zappa, you know. I caught it from the toilet seat and stuff like that. So I thought, well, that's not that bad. Yeah, come on, I'll sing this. No, okay, I'll blame Chris's uncle.
Well, you know, it's so funny. First off, you're gonna make my best friend really happy that you mentioned Zappa, because he's a huge Zappa fan. But I can totally see that whole concept, especially within hard rock, about like, why take yourself constantly so seriously, you know. Like, you know, I mean, not saying that it sounded like it, but that's kind of like with AC/DC, right? Like, they would have these incredible songs, but then you'd turn around and they'd have like Big Balls, you know, or like Whole Lot of Rosie, you know what I mean? Which was kind of like tongue-in-cheek and kind of silly, you know. But it broke up the kind of,
and the jack
that was another one. You know, like,
that is such a fucking masterpiece. Those lyrics are so good. So double meaning, you know. I learned through not only through Zappa, but Deep Purple did that as well, where lyrics have double meanings, you know.
Right.
And mostly a little bit sexist, you know, because in the older days you could be sexist and get away with it. That doesn't work anymore. And you know, so it's like it's funny, you know. It's all humor. Big Balls. That's another. It's so good, you know. And there's this modern band that my daughter Juliana listens to. And I hear her, I listen to what she's playing sometimes, and this guy goes, burn, motherfucker, burn, you know. Ever heard that? You know?
Yes, I know exactly. I think it was the Bloodhound Gang, I think is what they were called.
Yeah, exactly. I don't even know this band, but I love that part.
That's great. But again, it kind of showed this kind of clever side. But, you know, another thing that you and I had talked about, like when we were kind of texting back and forth, was that you had said something about how you felt like Krokus's albums, like, you know, especially early on, were just like these kind of metal albums, and they were kind of this hard rock raw, you know. They were like very much Krokus. But then you kind of got to like The Blitz and Change of Address, which I still love those records, but I agree with you when you said that they were very polished and very slick. They didn't have that grittiness that, say, like, you know that Headhunter Hardware had, you know.
Yeah, we went through this whole unfortunately, at the zenith of our career, you know, when Headhunter was number 24 in the Billboard charts, you know, a band from Little Switzerland in Europe, where there's hardly any hard rock bands at that time.
Right.
It's number 24 in the Billboard charts. But, you know, the people behind us wanted more, you know. They weren't only looking at Krokus having a success of our lives, you know, and almost platinum, and, you know, they wanted more, and their more translated into asking us. He said, you guys got to become more commercial, you got to lose that gritty sound and polish up your act. And, you know, I mean, and they used Def Leppard. We were on tour with Def Leppard then. Mm-hmm. This was the biggest tour of our lives. It was a sold out, the biggest rock tour in the USA. Def Leppard was number two underneath Michael Jackson with Thriller. It was one of the best years of our lives, mm-hmm. you know, our success, Def Leppard's success, Michael Jackson, the whole scene was all, everybody was consuming music. Record companies had millions of dollars to spend on bands. You know, this was, you know what I mean? It was like heaven on earth. And then they come and say, we gotta, you know, sidestep and get more commercial rent, you know. And we grew up trying to kind of get harder and harder, you know. So, and Chris, you know, who was the founding member, Chris Von Rohr,
right,
and yes. bass player, and kind of you know, he did the musical direction for the band, right?
Right.
And later became producer and so on. But time, he kind of imploded or exploded, mm-hmm. you know, and it was, things got really nasty and stuff. And then we kind of entered a negative spiral downwards, you know.
Right.
So suddenly Chris was out of the band. We, you know, and we went out, started songwriting and with a new drummer, you know, and a new bass player, and, you know, and Fernando took over musical direction, you know, mm-hmm. because I mean, he's been in the band much earlier than me, and musically is more able. He came up with some of the best riffs in the band, if not most,
right?
And so, you know, it was great respect. And but then our demos were still sounding too hard and too gritty, so they were taken apart by the following producers, you know. Mm-hmm. And it's amazing, you know, when we did the Blitz, there was Bob Rock as assistant producer or engineer, working together right. with, God rest his soul, Bruce Fairbairn.
Oh,
really
yes.
nice guys, you know. Yeah, and they were famous for Loverboy, you know, Loverboy.
Yes.
And also Bryan Adams.
Mm-hmm.
So both commercial, you know, melodic rock bands and stuff. And, you know, so we started drifting into this direction without Chris there to control the drift, you know.
Right.
Because I have to give him his due. And, you know, when in retrospect, later on, we realized we'd done a mistake, and our manager, who was, you know, the main guy who wanted to see Chris go,
right?
So we would have a open road and go in that direction that they wanted us to do. Was the first guy who said, you know, I think we should call Chris back, And that's when Heart Attack was written, you know.
Oh, yeah.
But by then, grunge was here, and, you know, and like even when we played in New Orleans with Iron Maiden, it was only a half sold out hall, you know, the big huge dome they have there,
right? Yes.
And which was quite disappointing, and this was with Iron Maiden, you know. I mean, holy shit, these guys sell out. I mean, you know, they was selling out huge places, and so we realized, you know, that you can't fight grunge, and we were road weary. I was burnt out by that time. Mm-hmm. I'd had enough of, and I thought, well, time to call it a day, you know. I really did, and I was happy when the tour ended and I could fly back to Europe and then onto my little island in the Mediterranean and just hang out on the cliffs and watch the sunsets and sunrises and meditate on what to do next, you know. It was so intense that was the most intense part of my life, giving out energy, all that energy every day on stage or songwriting or singing in studios and stuff. And yeah, even partying.
Well,
that needs energy, you know, although it's a positive thing.
Right. But, yeah.
You know, when you're out there and lonely on the road, you know, it's important to be able to loosen up.
No, it totally is. And, you know, to kind of go back a little bit with what you said earlier about grunge, which I loved what you said, is that it kind of came in. It was a new style of music, and you said, but they were still good bands. And I feel like so many, you know, like I said, like, you know, I grew up old school heavy metal kid, you know, and when grunge kind of came in, yeah, I didn't like a lot of it, but you know, I didn't like a lot of metal either. But when I started hearing bands like, you know, like Soundgarden and Alice in Chains, or even Pearl Jam, who seemed to be at the time have more like a classic rock kind of sound, I didn't feel like it was competing with metal. I just kind of feel like that, at least now, you know, in my mid-40s, I look at it and I go, it's kind of like a cycle, you know, like, you know, it was time for something new to come around, just because that's how life and that's how the world and that's how art is. But then Krokus,
yeah, that's
totally,
how it is.
Right.
Yeah. And it suddenly made, what we were doing looked jaded, you know.
But at the same time, it also made it kind of exciting, because a lot of these bands were coming out and saying, you know what, like, I was a big fan of bands like Iron Maiden. I liked Krokus. I actually heard David Grohl one time say that he was a Krokus fan. Do you know what I mean? And I was just like, this is cool, because these people, you know, even though they weren't playing the same style of music later on, they had respect and they had some, you know, they weren't afraid to admit that they were fans of certain bands. But all of a sudden, metal started to have this kind of a renaissance, too. And when it did, Krokus was right there again, ready to kind of come back. So how was that for you, knowing that, like, you know, you were there for the beginning, you were there for the decline, and then you were there for the comeback? So what was that like to see from your perspective, that when metal, all of a sudden, people wanted it back again? And the old school bands, for that matter.
Yeah, yeah. It just makes me feel like I'm on my third life, you know, that I've been living forever. Yeah, because, you know, I was in the progressive rock scene, mm-hmm. with a band called TEA in Switzerland during the 70s. And that's when I did my first rounds, you know, like in the bus, on the road, opening for bigger bands, and the last one of the last bands we opened with was Queen. Can you believe that?
Oh my gosh, really?
So yeah, and I watched every bloody sound check.
At the time, you probably don't even realize what you're seeing, but then looking back now, you're like, we toured with Queen. You know, like, that's pretty amazing to think about.
Yeah, it. Yeah, it's of course, it has more weight when you talk about Queen today. but everyone's talking about them. It's like everywhere you look, it's Queen, 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 and they did a great movie, and I thought it was great. I thought they were great then, and they became our idols in the 70s, you know. And then things changed, and new stuff came, heavy metal and hard rock, and, you know, yeah. It's been a nice life. When I look back, I feel lucky to have been a part of it, and to have seen it, as you said, rise and fall and come back. And I'm glad to still be around. And Krokus has reached the last phase. We've been doing the Adios Amigos tour in 2019. Mm-hmm. We played so many great festivals. And it was a great experience. And now we have the video and DVD out. And during a time when there are no live concerts anymore, so it's a great timing to come out with that. And I'm looking forward to the future, because I haven't been sitting on my ass watching TV every night. I've been creative, and I got together with a couple of guitar players over the internet and created stuff. And I've got enough songs to fill up three albums, but I just picked up the best 12, and we're going to record 10 of them, and I'll release my first solo album officially, hopefully beginning of next year, I guess, if unless Corona suddenly disappears with the next hurricane, you know.
You know, I'm so glad you brought that up about the Adios Amigos tour and the solo album. But what I wanted to ask you about the Adios Amigos tour was that there were talks of you guys returning to the U.S. as part of that tour.
Yeah.
Is there any chance that you guys might still make it back in like 2022 or something, and give people like me a chance to say, you know, yeah, long stick is boom.
I really hope so. You know, I have all my fingers and all my toes are crossed that we're still going to be able to give, because I mean, there's a lot of fans that bought tickets, and I guess they still have those tickets, and those will be re-evaluated or whatever you call that. Uh-huh. And they can come, and hopefully the band, all the band members are still going to be alive by then, and including myself. We try keeping fit, and we don't see each other. You know, I live in Basel, they live in Solothurn. But anyway, there's this social distancing crap which we have to abide to, which is important.
Exactly.
Because the sooner we get rid of this what can you call it, this dreaded plague, the sooner we can all bunch up together again and kick ass and rock and roll, you know. Otherwise, it's going to keep moving away from us, moving away. And that's what it's doing now. It's really frustrating.
It really is frustrating, because the people who complain that they can't go see shows are the ones that are more responsible for it not going away because they don't want to stop hanging out, you know? And so it's like, I keep telling people, I was like, if
I think
really,
we have to invest in you know, in social distancing and do the right things. I'm having my first vaccination in 2 days' time.
Oh,
and
fantastic.
I'm looking forward to it.
Yes.
And it's the way to go, you know. Mm. That's what we have to do, you know. What else can he do?
Krokus's use in pop culture. Like, you guys were name-dropped in Beavis and Butthead as being a great band. But then there was a Volkswagen commercial where this American woman is driving through her neighborhood and she's talking about how much she loves Krokus. Like, did you see that commercial? Did you know about it before it came out? And
I've heard about it. I've never seen that, though. No, you know, these, I don't know who made that deal, but
I'll send it to you because it is one of the funniest. They don't have any of the music in it, but she just mentions, she says, I loved Krokus. She goes, I toured with them all through like 1980 something. She goes, I got so excited at one show, I passed out. Like, this is amazing.
Yeah, and did you hear about the astronaut who took Krokus music? I guess it was a cassette in those days.
No!
Into space? Yeah. Yeah. That's another story, which is great, you know?
Well, see, you guys have actually left the planet. That's pretty awesome. Like, that's pretty rocking when you go to space, you know? I mean, I can imagine just even hearing the mention of your band, you know, whether it be like I said, like in a commercial or Beavis and Butthead or whatever. Like, there's got to be some sort of a cool feeling to you to where you're like, okay, wow, there's still some sort of relevance to what we do, even if we're just being named in things like this. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. No, it's nice to hear. Even younger bands or same age bands that, you know, if you're reading an interview and the name Krokus comes up, you know, it's great that we're still remembered because we sure put a lot of energy into it and we gave it our best years, if you like, you know. And so that's great. And we still have a large fan following in the USA and Canada. Mm-hmm. And as I said, we'd love to go back and finish the tour that we already had booked. Mm-hmm. And there's some dates in Mexico we would like to do that haven't been due to Corona, and also in Britain, you know, Great Britain. And there's, in the meantime, there's been some new offers coming in Europe again, you know, but we said we'd end in Europe with the concert we did in Zurich last this December 2019. And that was great. Very emotional. It was very emotional, you know, knowing it's the last the last one. Yeah, but at the back of my head, you know, I always had this thing, you know, it's going to be, you know, the last with Krokus, but I'm going to carry on. There's no way I'm going to just become a couch potato or something like that, or just spend the rest of my days, you know, fishing or whatever. You know, although that's very, it's very trendy to go fishing right now. I'm looking forward to the future, man.
Well, so tell me a little bit about your solo album, because this is something that's, like, again, for me as a Marc Storace fan and a Krokus fan in general, like, I love your voice and your work. What can you tell me about the album,
Thanks.
The solo material? Like, what is it going to be like? Like, what can we expect from you?
Ooh. well, it's going to be a rock album.
Mm-hmm.
And there's going to be maybe a couple of very fast songs, a couple of medium fast songs, you know, medium songs, medium tempo, and a couple of balladesque songs, you know. All in all, it's right now trying to, out of those 12 favorites, trying to choose 10, you know. It's always difficult to throw, which one should I throw out, you know. Right. And I'm very pleased about this blues song that's on it, you know. And I guess it's far too early to start talking about that right now, because, you know, Krokus is still alive, although we're right now in limbo, if you like. And I'm looking forward to working with them as long as it goes, you know. I'm not going to be the one who pulls the plug on Krokus ever. So my solo thing is intended to run parallel, you know. And whenever I have the time, I want to keep on writing songs and recording, and maybe do a video or two and go on tour. I'd love to get back on the road, you know, as soon as the whole thing opens up and everything is safe again, and I want to be out there. Yay!
Well, I'm going to be totally honest, Mark. I want you out here. I want you here in Atlanta. And, like, you guys can actually crash here in my basement if you want. Like, we can even set up a show in the backyard. I don't care. I just want to see Krokus. I want to sing along with the songs. And, you know, I honestly got to tell you, Mark, this has been such a pleasure to talk to you. And you are such an incredibly nice person. And this has really been a dream for me. I really appreciate that.
My pleasure. You know, it's always good to talk to spirited people who are into what we're into, and you're still young, and you know, and you play in a band, right?
Yes, I do.
What's the band called?
We're called Collins Drive. We're just kind of like a roots rock band.
Cool. What can you compare yourselves to?
Oh gosh, probably kind of like that's a good one. We've heard a lot of different descriptions. We've heard people say that we kind of sounded like Neil Young, or some people said that we kind of sounded like a not as good Rolling Stones sometimes, or like a not so good Rolling Stones.
Okay.
You know, it's just
okay.
It's
so just, you're not a perfectionist, man.
No. You know, I grew up in the South. You know, so I'm a storyteller. I like to write lyrics and write songs. So, you know, I'm not a great singer, but you know, we have fun. We have a little following. We've put out some music, and you know, but like you said, like even on this level,
and you sing, right?
Yes. I try very hard. Don't always succeed.
Singing is singing. You know, there are 100 different ways to sing. You know, and sometimes you just have to get a message across. And other times you want to get technique and melody and stuff across. And sometimes there's more percentage of one thing than the other, or vice versa. So whatever it is, it's still singing. You know, Bob Dylan's a singer too.
You know, and it's so funny because I'm a big fan of Bob Dylan also. And one of the things I remember talking to somebody who was a songwriter and singer also here in Georgia, he told me one time, he said, you know, he goes, you don't have to be the greatest singer, but if you have great songs, that's what matters, you know? And so I've always tried to say, okay, you know, I can't sing incredible, but you know what, if I can write a good song, that's what I really want. And your voice is the vehicle to put out what you're trying to say.
Exactly.
And your message. And,
exactly.
You know, like, I'm a pretty decent folk rock singer. I'd be a horrible metal singer.
As long as you find your fans, you know, your place, you have your platform, then and you write good lyrics too, then you're gonna find your way. Yeah. Doesn't have to be hard rock.
Good Lord. See, not only have I talked to one of my legendary favorite artists, I've also got banned advice from him as well. This has been a great day for me.
That's cool, Don.
Well, Mark, that's cool. I could talk to you all day, obviously, but I'm gonna let you go so you can go live a little bit and write some, though. But I really do appreciate you taking the time to talk with me and share some stories and just kind of flatter this old Krokus fan.
My pleasure. My pleasure. Glad you enjoyed. And I hope you people out there listening are okay and stay safe and rock on. Enjoy listening to your music and watching videos and movies you love until the whole thing is gone, you know, Corona. And yeah, so I hope you enjoyed. I hope to see you soon, and let's rock the world together again.